Good morning and welcome to The Journey. Whether you're with us here online or with us in person, welcome. We're glad to have you. I'm Pastor Tim, and so our message today is joy, wonder, delight, doubt, peace, restlessness, sorrow, contentedness, anxiety, confidence, hope, hearted. We lay our hearts filled with these things before our God. We're burdened and awaiting. Let us worship. Will you pray with me? Pray with me. Dear Father, we come and we come to worship with you today. Guide our hearts and our minds. And whether we're celebrating,
Michelle, she's not here today, her family aren't here today, But she has offered to do children's church for us, and so that's going to start. And I also have an application for a nursery worker. So some things are finally coming together, and I'm really excited about that. So hopefully we will continue to grow as a church family. We will continue to experience God's love from Him and from each other. And I'm just really excited for what's about to come. So if you will, let's stand and continue to worship for a few minutes. Actually, you can be seated. I like it. We're going to do our mindfulness moment. The scripture says, from now on, brothers and sisters, if anything is excellent and anything is admirable, focus your thoughts and meditate on these things. All that is true, all that is holy, all that is just, all that is pure, all that is lovely, and all that is worthy of praise. Practice these things. Whatever you've learned, perceived, heard, or saw in us, and the God of peace will be with you. I'm excited. Sean, Sarah, and I have scheduled our trip, and we will be teaching on trauma-informed faith communities at Solarize in L.A. in just a couple of weeks. If you would like to be a part of that, ask us and we'll tell you how to download the app. It is going to be an amazing conference. One of my favorite authors is going to be there, Brian McLaren, talking about humane spirituality. That is the theme of Solarize this year, humane spirituality. And there are numerous spiritual innovators who are going to be there. If you would like to get involved, let us know. And I will tell you, this may be a little controversial for some people, but I think for our tribe, it's a good thing. There will be other faith groups represented at Solarize, so we might hear from some of our Baha'i brothers and sisters, we might hear from some of our Muslim brothers and sisters, we might hear from some of our Buddhist brothers and sisters, and so those are exciting things, at least for me, to hear other perspectives in practicing humane spirituality. So if you'd like to be a part of that, please let me know. So if everyone can, please close your eyes for a moment and take a deep breath in through your nose and out through your mouth, in through your nose and out through your mouth, and begin to relax. Begin to relax. And I want you to start today's mindfulness moment by thinking of a small thing that you're thankful for. Think of a small thing. Maybe it was warm water in the shower. Maybe it was comfortable socks. I was thankful for a towel and a cup of coffee when I got out of the shower. But small things. What's one small thing that you can be grateful for? Flip-flops, beautiful weather. But that small thing, think about that small thing. And give thanks to God in your heart and in your mind. Express thankfulness. And a deep breath in through your nose. Now I want you to think of a big thing that you're thankful for. Maybe it's a person. Maybe it is a possession. Maybe it is an opportunity. But I want you to think of a very big thing that you are thankful for. And I ask you to thank God for it right now. And express your gratitude. Because we worship a triune God, the creator of the universe, Father, Son, and Spirit, let us think of a third thing that we are thankful for.
want you to think about something you're looking forward to. Maybe it's today, maybe it's this week, maybe it's this month. But something that you're looking forward to. All of God's people say, Amen.
Now, all right, we will begin the prayers of the people. As always, there is a refrain. I will say, Lord, have mercy, and then we will say, hear our prayer all together. Ask and you will receive, search and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, whoever seeks finds, and everyone who knocks, the door is opened. Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayers.
We pray for the comfort and healing of all those who are suffering with physical illnesses, mental illnesses, and emotional or spiritual hardships. We pray especially for Robert that his CART therapy is successful, for Charlotte who is experiencing various health issues, for Darla who faithfully and diligently cares for her mother, for Kathy, who has spinal stenosis, for Steve Gann's family, for Riot, who is improving but still in the hospital, for the people of Haiti who are dealing with the ramifications of earthquakes, for Christy Hash, who is mother Barbara passed away recently, for the people of Afghanistan, that they might experience peace in the midst of a power transition, for friends of the journey who have COVID-19, for Jennifer's son Clark, who has been diagnosed with scoliosis, for Mike Snyder, whose brother Greg passed away recently. We also pray for those who have died in the hope of the resurrection. We pray especially for Barbara Lund, for Steve Pan, for Greg Snyder, and for all those who are affected by their passing. God, we know that your love for these people is far greater than we could ever imagine, and that you and your goodness are already doing all you can to heal and restore each of them. Let us open our hearts to receive your comfort and be your hands to feed in the lives of all who experience suffering. Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. We pray for blessings, especially for the husband of Carmen Reno. We thank you, Lord, that you desire for him to receive your wisdom, guidance, and loving kindness. For Nikki, who is transitioning to an RGM position,
us locked up, that keep us weighted down from becoming everything that God has created us to be. And then beyond that, we're talking about how to become free and what we can do to cope and to grow and to overcome being trapped in these situations. So I have a question for you. Have you ever experienced serious anxiety? Have you ever experienced debilitating anxiety? You know, that anxiety that keeps you in bed, that anxiety that keeps you from participating in life, that anxiety that scares you so bad, it will even keep you from things that you wanted to. I know not everyone has experienced that type of anxiety, but I know I have. And I know there are people out there that have. And so today, we are going to continue our sermon series by talking about worry and anxiety. Now, it's important to kind of understand the difference between depression and anxiety. We're going to be talking about getting free from depression next week, but we're going to look at anxiety this week. And the best way that I can compare the two is depression comes from worry and fear and regret of the past. It comes from worry, regret, and fear of the past. Whereas anxiety comes from worry and fear of the future, right? We're scared of the future. Depression has us looking back and makes us regretful and hurt about things that have happened to us or things we've done in the past. Whereas anxiety, we're scared of what's going to come. Scared so much sometimes that we freeze, right? In fact, anxiety is often the result of a traumatic experience or the fear of a traumatic experience to come. But what's interesting about this is that there are ways to overcome worry and anxiety. But, on the other hand, if we don't take worry and anxiety very seriously, we as people can become frozen in a cycle where we live in this fear of what is to come, and it keeps us from becoming everything that God has created us to. You will hear this said over and over in the life of the journey. Our lives move in the directions of our most dominant thoughts. Hear that again. Our lives move in the directions of our most dominant thoughts. So if our most dominant thought is worry, fear, and anxiety, that's the direction our lives began to be lived. And some of us may even be saying right now that our lives are stuck there. So where is there hope? Well, I want you to know, while I am a Christian, I'm also an honest Christian. And I will tell you, I'm not just going to tell you to pray your anxiety away. Right? I'm not just going to tell you, well, you just need to get out of bed and do better. Right? You just need to suck it up, buttercup. And there are things that I believe you need to suck up, buttercup, every once in a while. But when it comes to dealing with worry and anxiety, I think the scripture provides for us an understanding of how people have existed over time and some of the things that they've done to overcome worry and anxiety. And I think we can also talk a little bit about some strategies today. Now, I will tell you, as a board-certified therapist, I do think that I am more than qualified to help share with this as a pastor and a therapist. And so, here's what I want to challenge you with today. If you deal with anxiety, please take this seriously. If you don't someone else. Okay? So if you will, let's open in our Bibles. We're going to start out, we're going to jump around a lot today, but we're going to start in Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. And we're going to start, or not Matthew 6. Oh my goodness, no. Matthew 6, not 26. Matthew 6. And we're going to start in verse 25. And this is from the CEB. Let's hear what the Word of God has to say this morning. It says, "Therefore I say to you, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds in the sky. They don't sow seed or harvest grain or gather crops into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth much more than they are? Who among you, by worry, can add a single moment to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? Notice how the lilies of the field grow. They don't wear themselves out with work, and they don't spin clothes. But I say to you that even Solomon, in all of his splendor, wasn't dressed like one of these. If God dresses grass in the field so beautifully, even though it's alive today, and tomorrow it's thrown into the furnace, won't God do much more for you? You people of weak faith. Therefore, don't worry and say, what are we going to eat, or what are we going to drink, or what are we going to wear? Gentiles long for all these things. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Instead, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, stop worrying about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble as of its own." Worry comes from the German word, worgen, meaning to choke or to strangle. And I think those of us that have truly experienced debilitating anxiety would agree with that word, strangle. Right? Anxiety almost strangles us from experiencing a joyful life. It strangles us from doing the things that we even need to do sometimes or have to do sometimes. You know, there have been times in my life where I've dealt with so much anxiety that the things that were critical for even my own well-being, I could not accomplish. And I'm sure others of you have been there. Now, I will tell you, at one point in time, I came from a belief that depression and anxiety came from sin issues. That's bad theology. That is horrible theology. Yes, sometimes it can come from a sin issue. I'm not going to, right? If depression looks at the past and we're regretful about things, if we've dealt with some conviction, yes, we may be depressed. And we may be fearful of something to come because we did something bad or wrong, right? Like if you go and rob a bank, you may have some anxiety about going out in public because you might run into the cops. Like, I'm not going to say that sin, right, can't cause these issues in our life. I will say that, but I will also contend they're not the only causes of depression and anxiety in our lives. That's bad theology. So, I want to talk a little bit about what the Scripture says. In 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, "God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." Matthew 6:25, as we heard earlier, says, "Do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes?" Listen to these scriptures and hear that the way God intended us to live was not as people of fear, was not of people as of worry and anxiety, right? That was not the original design for us. And so don't think that God wants you to be this way. Don't think that God is putting this on you or created this in you. I will tell you, I believe this is part of our struggle as living as imperfect human beings. I also believe that every good thing comes from God, and depression, anxiety, worry are not good things. And so I don't believe they came from God at all. So what can we do then? How can we wrestle with this idea for those that live with anxiety and those who wish to help people with anxiety? What then do we have to really think about? Well, first I want to say, if you are a person who is struggling with anxiety, it is not your fault. Right? Hear this. It is not your fault. The scripture tells us that we wrestle with things that aren't flesh and blood, but powers of darkness and deception, things that are not of God. And whether or not you believe in demons or Satan or anything, anxiety is a darkness. It is a dark power. And if you are a person who does not deal with anxiety, or maybe you're a person who finds it easy to come over the anxious times in your life, I want to say to you, as you look at people who truly struggle with anxiety, don't be judgmental. Right? Don't be that person that says, well, if you would just take care of things, or if you would just try a little harder. I had one patient that I met with in counseling, and their husband constantly told them, well, if you would just go and sit out in the sun. Yeah, that's not how this works. Like, God did not create us that way. But he did create us to be able to work with others and even work on ourselves, that over time we may overcome anxiety. Because he didn't create us to be fearsome or worrisome or anxious. So what then can we do, or what can you help others do? Well, if you want to, turn in your Bible in James 1:22, and it's just a quick little verse that says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Now, you're going to say, Justin, so are you just telling me to not sin more? Because that's what it sounds like you're telling me. To, like, follow this list of rules. If I would just follow this list of rules, No. Not at all. I'm not making that argument at all. But I do want to talk about some of the commands that God does give us. God gives us commands not as a legalistic identity, but as a way to encourage us, because he knows how we work. The first thing that I would suggest that Scripture tells us to do is to practice gratitude. Practice gratitude, right? We talked, in fact, Tim gave us Scripture last week in the call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. Now you're going to say, but Justin, just give thanks to the Lord. So let's put it in a therapeutic sense, okay? Let's put it in a therapeutic sense. I want everyone who is here today, and I want everyone who's going to join us online, to, whether you do it in a phone or you actually get a paper type of journal, I want you to begin a list of things that you are grateful for. And every day, try to wake up, set an alarm on your phone, and wake up every day and write down a few things that you are grateful for. Because I will tell you, here's the amazing thing. The Bible doesn't tell us this, but science tells us this. That when we practice gratitude for 21 days straight, when we are literally thankful and grateful, And while we are filling our minds with things to be grateful for, it actually pushes out the room of those negative thoughts, those anxious thoughts in our brains. When we have an attitude of gratitude, it truly does begin to change our lives. Now, don't just do this for 21 days. Do it beyond 21 days. Right? Your brain changes chemistry for a while, but your brain can change back. Here's also the other thing I want to encourage you with. After these 21 days, or maybe even in the 21 days, there may be days where you feel really low and you feel really bad. I was meeting with a young man, it was last Monday, and we were talking, and I asked him, what are three things that you're grateful for? He was having a rough day. And he said, I can't think of any. And I was like, you can't think of anything that you're grateful for? And he's like, no, not right now. I feel that bad. And I want you to know that's a skip. He wasn't in this oh, poor is me mentality. He was really wrestling with things. And here's where this journal becomes a second benefit. You know, there are days that people who deal with anxiety feel so low that they can't think of anything that they're grateful for. And so with that journal, you have the opportunity to look back and remind yourself of things that you can be grateful for. Here's also another interesting trick when it comes to psychology. Did you know that if you focus on something for 17 seconds, that ignites the neural pathways in your brain to focus on those things? Well, think about it. When you're in an anxious place and you're dealing with anxiety, you're thinking about that all the time, your brain's just going. Open up that journal and begin to read those things. You know how I know that statistic is really true beyond the science? Think about what most people do when they're in debilitating anxiety. What do? They Netflix. They Hulu. They turn on something to make their brain just go somewhere else so they can just begin to cope. But the problem is, as soon as they get a little energy, maybe from watching that or thinking that life is different, they turn it off and their brain goes back. So find things that you can do. I'll tell you, one of the things that I like to do, this sounds so strange, I begin to repeat lists to myself or things that I have memorized. You're going to think this is funny, but when I was younger and my children were younger, one of the things that I taught them early on, in fact, Lillian, who now is one of our pastors, she knew the Greek alphabet before she knew the regular alphabet, right? Alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, zeta, eta, theta, iota, kappa, lambda, mu, nu, xi, omicron, pi, rho, sigma, tau, epsilon, phi, chi, psi, omega, phi. So some days I just sing the Greek alphabet to myself. Right? It makes me think of seminary. It makes me think of joyful thoughts with my kids. Lists of things that I'm happy for. Sometimes listing people that I've connected with. Sometimes I begin to pray for the people in our congregation. I'll tell you, when we were at FCC, that list was much larger. So it took way more than 17 seconds. But, you know, but begin to go over lists that begin to distract you and begin to change the way you're thinking. You know, the scripture also tells us to confess our sins one to another, and that we will receive healing. I think a better translation, and this is the Justin Meyer translation, is confess your issues one to another. Right? Tackle those things that you're dealing with. One, you can call me because I'm a therapist and maybe I have some good ideas, but I will tell you, you can call anyone and say, you know, I'm really struggling with anxiety today. And I'll tell you, if a person calls you who says they are struggling with anxiety and depression, make sure you talk to them for a while. Don't hang up. Because that just is going to wreck them. Be a person of compassion. Be a person who cares. Because I will tell you, I went through a severe, anxious, traumatic moment at one point in my life. In fact, it changed my view of ministry and everything for a long period of time. I think I shared this with Sean just a week or two ago. But when Josiah was born, right, I had just started a job. We had just planted a church, River City Church in Lawrence, Kansas. It was a lot of fun. Had a bunch of people. But we ministered to a lot of college kids. We ministered to a lot of homeless people. We another congregation that in the beginning didn't have very many financial resources. So I took a job with NPR, and I started up. What's the best thing it's called? Producing book tours, pretty much. So an author would hire the company I was working for, and I would do interviews with them in different markets of NPR, right, with the different radios. And I would produce that, and we would ship that off, and different things like that. Well, it was my first week of work, and Josiah shouldn't have been here for another 3 months. But he decided to come. Well, only had one vehicle at that time, and that vehicle was at the hospital. I ended up having, because I was expecting to be picked up, I had to walk a few miles home from my job. Then I had to track down a ride to go get my car. Josiah was coming. I get on the turnpike. I'm driving to Stormont Vale in Topeka, Kansas, because they have one of the best NICUs in the area. And I freeze. I start driving erratic and sporadic, and like I am just shaking in fear. And I'm anxious, because I think this child that's supposed to be mine is probably going to die. And I am just shaking and shaking. So I pull off the side of the road. And at that time, I was in a denomination where we had conference ministers or regional ministers. In some denominations, they're known as bishops. In other denominations, they're known as district superintendents. And so I called mine. And I told him what I was going through. He says, "Well, Justin, that sounds really bad. We'll pray for you." And he hung up on me. I was freaking out. I was struggling hard. The next thing I do is I just begin to dial for my contacts. And finally, my sister Jamie picks up. I think she's in the Air Force at that time. And she helps me get to the hospital. She stays on the phone. And she talks with me. She gets me there. And I'm able to get to the hospital. And I go straight to a nurse. And I'm like, "I need help. I have a kid that's going to be born here, but I need help." And they help me out. And finally, I'm there to see Josiah born under 2 pounds. He's about the size of a Barbie doll. His arm is literally smaller than my index. He's born with multiple holes in his heart. At that time, his eyes were still shut. When they opened, they were completely black. Freaky stuff. But that taught me you never hang up on someone who calls and talks to you about their depression or their anxiety. Luckily, my sister was there to save me. We have to be there for one another. The scripture in that King Solomon writes about two being better than one and three being even greater, right? He talks about things like being able to defend each other and keep each other warm and accomplishing more work. But I think it goes way beyond that. When we're talking about these issues of anxiety, when we're talking about these issues of worry, when we're talking about these issues,
you're stranded. And so I want you to know this morning, if you feel stranded, if you still feel stuck on an island, if you are struggling, please reach out. If I don't answer your phone call, send me a text and say, this is an emergency. Christina called on Wednesday, and I texted back, and that's the first thing I asked, right? Is this an emergency? I was literally teaching a class, but you know what? If it was an emergency, I was going to call. Because that's what's critical, right? We have to care for each other. We have to love for each other. And we do that by helping each other change our awful thinking. And we're not trying to fix each other either, right? We're not, you can't just make anxiety going away by saying, oh, it's going to be okay. I'll tell you, every day, sometimes Sarah gets into this anxious mindset because we take really serious that scripture that we actually read today. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. Right? So that means if we have a little extra money in the account and someone needs money, we give them money. If someone needs groceries, we buy groceries if the food pantry doesn't have enough groceries. We'll pay bills somehow. Whatever we can do. But sometimes the money's tight. And sometimes it's a little crazy. And Sarah gets sometimes in this anxious mindset of checking the bank account multiple times every day. Multiple times every day. And you know the least helpful thing I can do is say to her, God always takes care of us. Because he does. I'll tell you, last night, yesterday, I'm working, and we are in a tight spot right now financially. Tim has been there too, where you have jobs that you're doing, but they're in progress, right? I'm working on a debt right now for money for the church. I'm working on a house right now for money for my family. Both are spreading us pretty thin. I've been working on this house for over a month. Yesterday, I had to knock down an over 40-foot tree. We at least know it's 40 feet because it's like a huge house that stands at least. And so I have pictures. I sent them to Sean. And so I fell a tree yesterday. Huge old pine tree. Evergreen, maybe, not pine. And I walked into the people who own the house, and I said, hey, I have a favor to ask. I said, the saw that I have rented, because I don't have a chainsaw right now. Do you mind just covering that? I said I would take care of the tree so I could finish painting the house. And I have another one to knock down, too. I said, would you just mind covering the $75 for the saw rental? We're tight right now. They're like, oh, yeah, sure. And then I get this message, transferred money for via Venmo, right? It was way more than $75. It doesn't take care of all our issues, but it took care of that issue. We have enough money for gas this week to get around. I can rent the chainsaw one more time to go knock down the other tree. You know, but I will say God always shows up and shows off when things are tight. Because I think it's true when you seek first the kingdom of God and you seek to love people and help people. But you know what? Telling Sarah that God shows up every time we need him isn't necessarily a healthy thing, even though it's true. Right? What is true is, and what is good, is empathizing. And giving her reassurance that I love her and that I will work hard to make sure that we will make it. That if I have to, I will go to a food pantry to get extra food. That I will do the things, whatever it's going to take, to make it. Even though we have always made it. And God has always been good. And you know, Sarah is an amazing pleasure. When we started dating, she still had money left over from the earlier year. So like a whole year had passed. right? Let's sit and live in tension together. Let us care for people. What else does the scripture say? So, we need to do, and what I mean by doing what the scripture says, we need to give thanks. We need to remember, right? We need to rejoice. That's remember why we have joy. The next thing we need to do is we need to not only share the load with people, but also share the load with God. Listen to what Philippians 4, 6 through 7 says. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So, something that I learned from a Buddhist friend. And you're like, you just quote scripture and now you're going to talk about a Buddhist friend? Yes, I absolutely am. Live with it and deal with it. Because he made this scripture become practical to me. Okay? So, prayer. You know, it's a conversation with God. It really is. But sometimes just saying, okay, God, I'm struggling with it. What are we going to do now? Isn't always the most helpful thing. So my Buddhist friend said, Justin, say that prayer. Pray and give thanksgiving to God. Give your petitions and requests to God verbally. He said then, also write that stuff down. Write it out. Get it all out of you and write all your feelings down. God, I feel crappy. God, this sucks. God, I don't know what I'm going to do. Write all that down. Get it all out. Put it on a piece of paper. And then rip that stuff up. Throw it away. Really practice releasing things. Really get rid of it. Right? You're journaling the things that you're grateful for. You're sharing your burdens with others, and you're giving them to God. Folks, I will tell you, this isn't the be-all, end-all, cure-all as I wish it is, but I will tell you, it is the right direction. It is. Now, I'm not one of those pastors who thinks mental health is a bad thing, right? I'm going to tell you, if you can't get out of your debilitating anxiety or your debilitating depression, and we'll talk about depression next week a little bit. Here's the thing. Get some help. And if you don't want to talk to me because maybe I'm your pastor, that's okay. I get it. Maybe you have some stuff you don't want me to know about, and I'm okay with that. I will tell you, I try to create an environment of hope, help, and healing without judgment. Some of you have experienced that, but some of you are still scared. I get that. So here's what I want to challenge you in. Is find somebody. And if you need resources in helping find somebody, tell me. I have a lot of people I can direct you to. Whether you're here in Missouri or you're anywhere in the United States, there is a network of therapists that want to help people. And that will actually help people. If you can't afford it, you can find ways to take care of that too. But here's the thing. Anxiety does not have to strangle you from the life that God intended for you. But don't be alone. And I know that's a hard step sometimes. So if you can ever reach out, I'm here to call. And people, we people that we can reach, have people reach out to. If you need help with someone dealing with anxiety, please let me know. Because we don't have to be strangled. We don't have to be choked. We don't have to be hostage to the things that keep us from who we've been created to be. Amen? It is simply this, the gospel. Not to have a deeper relationship with you. So, we remember, as they remember, that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, he blessed it, he gave thanks, and he broke it. He said to his disciples, "Take and eat in remembrance of me." And in the same way, at the end of the meal, he took a cup, he blessed it, and gave thanks, and he said, "Take, each of you, and drink, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant shed for you and the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink in remembrance of me." So, as they did, so we also do. We come to this table to make a witness, a statement, and a testimony that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Say that with me. Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for today and this opportunity to gather together. Lord, we pray that you would transform these elements and that you would use them to transform us, that we may become everything that you have created us to be and to live the abundant life that Jesus said that he came to give us. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' precious name. All of us say, amen. The body of Christ given for you. Thanks be to God. The blood of Christ shed for you. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we be unified and transformed to be everything he has made us to be. And all of God's people say, amen. Here's what I want you to know about offering. Right now, you can give through the app, but the money isn't going directly into the bank account. Kate was not able to get to the bank on Friday, but hopefully she will get there on Monday or Tuesday. But I will tell you, we have a great need right now. There is a gentleman in our community that is dealing with, right now, it's a debilitating issue for him. It is a physical issue. And it doesn't have to be debilitating, but he can't afford to go to the doctor to get this. And so, our giving right now is going to go towards that. So, if you have a dollar, you have $5, if you have $10, whatever, you can give. Either give on the app, or today we're going to give to Sean since Kate's not here. I don't touch money. So, as the pastor, we don't do that. And so, Sean has his as a trusting pastor, we're going to give it to him. And not that, yeah, don't trust me with your money. That's what I'm saying. Don't trust me with your money. Trust Sean with your money. And he will make sure it gets to the account, and we will be able to help this gentleman. And like I said, if you can either give online or if you can give to Sean, we greatly appreciate that. Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you've given us. Help us to be a blessing to this gentleman, that in all things we may give you praise and honor and see your good work. And Lord, please empower us to be your hands and feet, to love, to bless, and to show compassion to others. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. All of us say, amen. Let's all stand and grab hands with one another. We're going to share germs, but if you don't feel safe to hold hands with someone, you don't need to. And we're all holding hands anyways. Repeat after me. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May his face shine upon you.
May his face shine upon you.
gracious unto you.
And be gracious unto you.
May the Lord lift his countenance upon you.
May the Lord lift his countenance upon you.
Give you peace.
Give you peace.
Remember this.